Good evening. Welcome to the October 16, 1996 Town Council meeting. This is meeting number 8 of our council year. Could we have the roll call, please?
Chairman McLaughlin.
Here.
Council Cogswell.
Here.
Council Groff.
Here.
Council Jordan.
Yeah.
Council Linnell.
Here.
Council McGinty.
Here.
And Council Reed.
Here.
Thank you. Would you please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag? I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. We have reports and correspondence from the council. Councilor Reed?
Madam Chairman, I'd like to report that the assignment for the bottle shed for the period beginning December 1996 through December 1998 has been done, and all those groups that have been assigned will be notified if they have not already been so notified. And I'd like to thank the citizens of this town. In about 4 years, over $75,000 of money will have been contributed to the youth of this town through the generosity of the people who donate their returnable bottles and cans at the transfer station. And thank you, and we hope that people will continue. As chairman of the Appointments Commission, I would like to alert people to the fact that we are now accepting and encouraging applications for the various boards and commissions, including but not limited to the Planning Board, the Zoning Board, the Fort Williams Advisory Commission, the Conservation Commission, the Thomas Memorial Trustee Library, trustees, I'm sorry, I can't seem to think, and the other boards and commissions, including cable. And applications are available in the town manager's office. Please see Barbara Ray and get them back to us, and we'll consider you when we hold our interviews during November and December. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Councilor Jordan?
Yes, I just want to report that as a representative of the county budget, that we've been working quite thoroughly on it and gone through it pretty well, and we reduced a few figures, and the wrap-up is tomorrow evening, starting at 6 o'clock. And you've probably all read a little bit in the paper what has happened as far as an automobile within the sheriff's department, and that isn't quite settled yet, because the trade-in of the vehicle was bought with county money, and they don't know just how we're going to solve it yet, whether there's drug money enough there to buy the vehicle or not. So we don't think it's quite right, majority of the committee.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Linnell?
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I have basically two announcements. One is, I think people, constituents should know that we regularly receive these letters from Maine Yankee, written to us as community leaders. And they talk about the safety at the plant, and I won't belabor this, but just to point out, because the other hat I wear is a spokesperson for Maine Safe Energy, but the safety at that plant, I think people have seen recently in the media and from the NRC, Nuclear Regulatory Commission, that it's a fairy tale. And I just wanted to point out that we receive these letters regularly, and I consider them little more than fairy tales and something to read perhaps before you go to sleep. Thank you. Secondly, on a different issue, Councillor McGinty and I have been working on the council's goals to work on substance abuse issues, and Councillor McGinty's worked very hard on this. I've been to a number of Cape Coalition meetings, and I'm serving as an interim member of the board of directors. We have someone in the audience tonight who I believe will have a couple of comments in a few minutes, but I just want to point out that the coalition hopes to do a what's called an asset survey, and this is not a drug survey, and I want to make sure people understand that. This would ask about 30 questions, things like, do youth in the community have an adult they can talk to if they need to? How much time do they spend on their homework? And if some students are perhaps a little gun-shy because of the previous drug survey, I think they will find this more refreshing. And if they have some issues that they would like to comment on in terms of how they view the community and the assets available to them, this is an opportunity for them to speak out. I think it's a totally different, has a totally different purpose than the previous drug survey. And also, there is a fundraising effort going on to raise money for that survey. And if people want to contribute to that, they can contribute through the town and earmark their donation for the Cape Coalition's or the fundraising effort, but they would make their check payable to the town of Cape Elizabeth. And finally, that the next meeting of the Cape Coalition is November 5th. I believe it'll be in the community center. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Councilor McGinty.
Ditto on everything that Bill said about the Cape Coalition. I won't belabor that myself. On September 18th, I attended the Maine Municipal Association's Legislative Policy Committee, as you say, in Augusta. This was the first meeting of the legislative year. It was basically an informational and introductory meeting. We didn't take any action on any particular issues at all. We did have a presentation by Evan Rickert of the State Planning Office regarding growth and development issues and incentives from the State Planning Office. As I said, we didn't take any action. Next meeting is scheduled for November 20th. Second issue, in reading the Fort Williams Advisory Commission minutes from September 19th, I was disturbed to see that they granted permission to a group from Brunswick to sell coffee and donuts at the fort next to the lighthouse. The event was the arrival of the QE2, the Queen Elizabeth II. I was down there myself. It was quite a crowd. I didn't get close to the lighthouse. It was too difficult to get there. But I'm concerned that the commission would allow a group, although a charitable group, outside of the town to use the fort for fundraising purposes. I think it sets a dangerous precedent. And so I'd just like to state that for the record. That's all.
Thank you. Councilor Jordan.
I have one other thing I just want to speak about. Some of the comments that I've heard at the transfer station, and I just got a couple of questions. The manager, is there a guard or something to stop the vehicles when they back down to dump their leaves in that area? Coming?
Yes, there is. That's why we have the compost that material there temporarily is until that the gate arrives that will be in that leaf drop-off area.
And the other comment has been that they don't like the idea of backing uphill to dump into those hoppers, as you might say. And I just want to remind you, you might need a sand truck there this winter when you get an ice storm, because mm-hmm. they might slide down through.
Mm-hmm. It is something we're going to need to watch. And I plan, now that I'm back, to try to spend a couple hours up there at a time just to observe what's going on. He has citizen comments. You know, it's obviously a major change, and you know, we really want to be responsive to people's concerns. As far as backing up, you know, if we could get people into a pattern of driving along the edge of it rather than backing, there's no reason that most of them couldn't do that. It was a compromise. I think, you know, the council's aware, the contractors wanted to be able to dump down into the bins rather than have to reach up, and you know, that was one of the things that happened. Obviously, we could have perhaps made it flatter on top, but I don't know if that really would have solved the problem. But we'll watch it and really try to encourage people to let us know their opinions, and if minor changes can be made in, you know, arrows, directions, lanes, all those things, we'll try to address them.
Well, that's what I, one comment that I got is, and I agree with 100%, should be some arrows there for the people to understand that they can go around and drive up there and not figure they have to back up there. It is this tremendous place now. I mean, it really looks good, what have you, but there's just, everybody isn't always satisfied in what goes on anyway.
Thank you, Councillor. I believe the town clerk has some information she wants to share with us?
Thank you, Madam Chairman. The election is upcoming, the general and special municipal elections. They will be held on Tuesday, November 5th, at the high school gymnasium. Polls will be open from 7 a.m. until 8 p.m. We do encourage anyone who would like to register to vote, to change your name, to change your address, to do that before Election Day, although the state law allows you to do it on Election Day. You may register to vote here at Town Hall during regular office hours, Mondays 7:30 to 5, Tuesday through Friday, 7:30 to 4. We will be holding two evening sessions for voter registration on Tuesday, October 22nd, and Tuesday, October 29th, from 4 to 6:30. We do require proof of residency and proof of identity, for instance, a driver's license indicating a Cape Elizabeth address. Those that are unable to attend the polls on Election Day, you may vote by absentee. Ballots are available here at Town Hall if you'd like to come to Town Hall and vote the ballot if you are able. If you are not able, you may call my office and order a ballot. It will be sent to you by mail. If you would like to request a ballot for a third party, you may do so if you are a family member, and that ballot will be sent to that family member. So we do encourage anyone to come to Town Hall to register to vote or request your absentee ballots as soon as you know that you will be unable to attend the polling place. Also, voting absentee means not only that you may be absent, but if you are unable to go to the polls. For instance, if you have a physical incapacity, if you feel you wouldn't be able to stand in line or to walk to the parking lot to the polls, we have a couple of folks that have indicated they've been injured the last couple of weeks and wouldn't be able to make it. Some of the elderly prefer to vote by absentee if it's difficult for them to get to the polls as well. If you have any problems, you know, with your vision or what have you, anything that you might feel uncomfortable coming to the polling place, please contact us. Or if you feel you can come to Town Hall, you may vote by absentee. During the next 2 weeks, we will be having voter registration and absentee balloting right here in the council chambers. Hopefully this will accommodate more room for people up in the tax office. It'll be a little bit congested, I think, with the amount of absentees that we're going to be voting in the next 2 weeks. So we will be trying to accommodate you as best we can. So please call us if you have any questions. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much. Just want to share some of the correspondence I've had recently. I have a letter from the Archangel Committee that I've shared with the council this evening. They have a reception next Monday afternoon at Portland City Hall, and encourage councilors to attend that if they're able to. To remind everybody about our fall heavy item pickup, you all should have gotten in the mail the bright orange flyer on this, in keeping with the time of year, supposedly. It's Monday, October 28th through the week. That includes Wednesday, November 6th. If you have questions about the heavy-duty item pickup, please be in touch with the Public Works Department. They're at 799-4151. Mr. McGovern alluded to the fact that he has returned one of the components of his absence was a visit to Cape Elizabeth by the person who holds the equivalency of the town manager position in the Shire of Eacham, which is in Malanda, Australia. And that's where Mr. McGovern will be traveling next spring when he does his traveling part of this exchange. We did have a reception for these folks and received just a wonderful gift. I don't know if we can get this, all this on the camera. You probably know I rarely, if ever, use a gavel, and that evening I had commented, because we had people on both sides of us, that the one time in my life I wanted a gavel, well, after we did our intros and everything, we were presented with a gavel. It was very appropriate and very timely. This is made out of a wood that is native to that part of Australia, pink waratha. I think I've said it right. Finally, it took a long time. And the plaque on it reads, presented to Town of Cape Elizabeth from Eacham Shire Council, Australia, ICMA/IMM Manager Exchange 96. So we're delighted to have another gavel up here, and may have to actually use a gavel once in a while now. It's absolutely lovely and very lightweight wood. Very impressed with our visitors. We had a great time with them, and look forward to hearing Mr. McGovern's accounts when he does his trip and comes back. We'll come back. That's part of it. And I did share with the council the very nice letter that we had from Mayor English of that community. Another announcement is that our November meeting will be on Wednesday, November 13th. This is due to a holiday following on the usual council evening. It will not be the second Monday. It will be Wednesday, the 13th, similar to what's happening this month. Remind the council and also for the citizens to know that the Greater Portland Council of Governments is having its local officials appreciation evening upcoming in about a week and a half on Monday, October 28th. They are looking for nominations for the Regional Citizen of the Year. If anybody has an appropriate nomination for that, if you would please be in touch with one of the counselors or with the manager by the end of this week is when they're looking for those nominations to be in. And just want to say that this community has lost a very dear friend very recently, Harris Plaisted, who was known as the father of Little League Baseball in the state of Maine. And it is for him that we named Plaisted Park across from Fort Williams. And he will be sorely missed. He had some wonderful energy for the youth of the community, and we're very grateful for his generosity and all of the commitment he had to our young people. Mr. McGovern, you wanted a couple of minutes?
Yeah, just I know the announcements have gone on for some time. I'll try to make this brief. I most of all want to have a number of thank yous to folks that have helped out recently. As Janet alluded to, I was on vacation for 2 weeks, and then I had a visitors from Australia for a week, which she didn't mention. Then I was at the City Managers Conference in Washington, D.C. with the folks from Australia. So there was about 28 days of which I was really only in the office working about 3 days. A lot of it was vacation time, which I needed to take and did. But anyway, during my absence, Deborah was the acting town manager, and as always, just did a superb job. And she not only had all her clerk's duties getting ready for the election, but also a tax due date, which causes a lot of activity in the office, a lot of citizens coming in with different issues. And I really want to express my deep appreciation to her for all that she did during my absence, not only this time, but throughout. It's really very much appreciated. Also, obviously, a burden really falls on Barbara Ray as well when I'm out, the secretary in my office, and I really appreciate her efforts as well, not only with that, but also helping with, particularly with Janet, to plan the visitors' itinerary when they came from Australia. And as well with that, all the department heads and everyone just could not have been more helpful with that visit, and I think it was a good learning experience for them as well as for the folks from Australia. Also, do want to note, while we're thanking folks, that Ernie McVean, I think as everyone aware, has been out for an extended period. I spoke to him today. We expect him back fairly soon. But his absence has really created a burden on Mira Rivado, on Lois Morrill, on Sandra Hanscom, Maureen O'Meara, and Jerry Daigle, all of whom work in that office. And you know, while it's been difficult to keep up at times, they have really come through, and I think it deserves special mention of all their efforts in keeping things in place. Next, I wanted to mention that we received a letter of resignation this past week from Jack Nichols, who serves as our community liaison officer recently, and previous to that served as a detective in our police department, and before that as a patrol officer. He was definitely recognized as one of the best detectives in the state, as evidenced by his hiring by the Maine Attorney General to be an investigator, which will be his new position. And he also you know, really made great strides working with the coalition and others and getting our community liaison officer position started. So he will be missed, and we certainly wish him well. He will be replaced in the community liaison officer by Officer Paul Gaspar, and Jack and Paul are now spending time together trying to prepare and move that along, so do want to thank Jack. The final point is, I don't often thank someone from another community, but there's a gentleman who's been in the background, has done an awful lot for the town of Cape Elizabeth, even though he never worked for the town of Cape Elizabeth, and he retired about 2 weeks ago from the city of Portland, George Flaherty. He was the director of Public Works there, and we all really loved George. He was, whenever there were bad snowstorms, he took the brunt of it from citizens and was really the person in the region more than anything else who represented Public Works employees and spoke well of them. And he's also helped us through regional waste systems with refuse disposal issues and, you know, has just done countless very quiet things for Cape Elizabeth over the years. And he's retired from the city of Portland. He's going to be the emergency management agency director for the county. And again, it's not often I thank anyone, people from another community when they retire, but George is a real special person and has helped us in so many ways. So I did want to make special mention of George. So thank you, Madam Chairman.
Thank you. I'll add a couple of thanks for your Australian visitors. Councillor Cogswell, I think, had a marvelous day with Tanya, and Barbara Ray also had some nice time with them. So it was a good team effort. We had a good time. Next on our list for the evening is approval of the minutes of our meeting held on September 9, 1996. Can I have a motion on that, please?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. We now have a time for citizens' discussion of items that are not on the agenda this evening. Is there anybody who would like to discuss something with us? Would you please go to the microphone? Give us your name and address, please.
Chairman, and I'm Virginia Whelan of Cape Elizabeth. I live at 971 Shore Road. It's just a stone throw from Fort Williams. And they have a caution light right where the post office is. You know where the post office is. Then they have a crosswalk there. The cars come so fast down the hill, I don't think they even see the caution light. You're supposed to slow down, aren't you? Well, they don't slow down. And I've tried to cross at the crosswalk. One policeman stopped for me to go across it, and somebody else since I was going across it, but I decided I didn't want to. I will walk down near Fort Williams first gate where the cars can't go up the first gate, and the cars usually coming that way from Cape Elizabeth are slower going, and then after they get around the fast corner, you can see them, so you can get across the street. And I mean, they must have the crosswalk there in a way for the post office people, but everybody that goes to the post office, they drive up in their car. They don't. You hardly ever see anybody walk across the street to go to the post office. So I don't know why the crosswalk, what good it does, really. I haven't been able to use it, but of course it's not a lot of people that walk. So, but there used to be people that come from Surf Road in Cottage Lane, and they have a hard time even getting across the street. I just don't know. Well, I don't. There's not enough people probably that use it, but I use it every day.
Thank you for bringing that to our attention. I will work with
Excuse
the.
Me?
Thank you for letting us know about this, and I will work with the manager and the police chief, and I will get back to
Write
you.
A letter.
I will get back to you.
Oh.
About anything we can do about it. Okay. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Madam Chairman.
Sir.
Just a comment in addition to what you said for Mrs. Whelan, we are already talking to the police chief about safety issues on Shore Road, and so you're pointing this out is very timely. And
there's going to be something on Shore
Road.
Yes,
there is already something, we're already talking to the police chief about it, and so your timing is perfect.
Well, South Portland slowed the people down when they put those round things in the street. It made a lot of difference down by DePetro's.
Right, mm-hmm. Right. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Is there anybody else? Yes, sir.
Madam Chairperson, member of the council, Mr. McGovern, my name is Kevin Sweeney, 7 Phillip Road in the Cape. I'm here tonight as co-chairperson of the Cape Coalition to bring a situation to your attention. I'd like to begin with a rhetorical question. That is, do you know what whipped cream, gasoline, room deodorizers, Freon, spot removers, whiteout, butane, nonstick cooking spray, hairspray, and propane have in common? The young people across the nation are using the gases and the fumes from these products to obtain a cheap and very legal high. We became aware of this situation in Cape Elizabeth back in June when CLO Jack Nichols made a presentation to the coalition and the community regarding the recovery of nitrous oxide canisters. In large quantities throughout Cape Elizabeth. Apparently, what has happened is that nitrous oxide is generally an anesthetic, and it's used as the propellant for aerosol whipped cream canisters. Our young people have discovered that you can get quite a little buzz on this. At the same time, with the do-it-at-home type of thing being in vogue, people have begun to manufacture whipped cream dispensers that can be used at home. They require a large quantity of these canisters that are readily available, and they are already available to our teenagers and younger people throughout the greater Portland area. These stores do in fact, or must in fact, recognize that they are being used for inappropriate uses, inasmuch as some of them are beginning to require a waiver holding them harmless if the substances are misused or abused. In any event, because of other controversies in the community at that time last June, that pretty much was overshadowed by those controversies. Recent developments have brought the coalition's attention back to this issue. I've asked Councilor Linnell to hand out some information, but there are some statistics regarding inhalant abuse throughout the United States that tells us that 20% of young people are using this to some extent or another. We've also had three situations in Cape at the end of August, one where the police recovered on their own a large quantity, 23, I believe, nitrous oxide canisters. Several days later, the police, responding to a citizen complaint, recovered another group of canisters. The citizen indicated that the recovery of the canisters was coincidental to some strange behavior by young people. Subsequent to that, just about 2 or 3 days later, there was an arrest at Kettle Cove of 3 juveniles in a vehicle, and along with the marijuana and other drug paraphernalia that was found was a quantity, again, of nitrous oxide canisters, as well as balloons and the tools that are used to open the nitrous oxide canisters. So in a very short period in Cape, we've seen a correlation between nitrous oxide canisters being found, inappropriate use behavior associated with nitrous oxide canisters, and finally, drug use associated with nitrous oxide. In the last few weeks, we've been working with Councilor Linnell, the police department, and other groups throughout the greater Portland area, and we have discovered, which we felt was the case, that nitrous oxide is not a Cape Elizabeth phenomenon. Nitrous oxide, as well as the other substances I indicated, are being used throughout the greater Portland area, probably throughout the state. We've decided that rather than wait for the typical Cape Elizabeth youngster to be injured or die from this type of thing, that we are going to spearhead an effort to address this issue. What we are asking for is that we are seeking an enforceable local ordinance, as well as state legislation that will ban the sale to an inappropriate possession of nitrous oxide by persons under the age of 18. We're also seeking an enforceable local ordinance and state legislation that will help parents, schools, and police officials control the inappropriate use and possession of products that lend themselves to inhalant abuse. And finally, on December 5th, we are sponsoring a community-wide education and awareness program on inhalant abuse throughout the greater Portland area. We have assembled a rather distinguished panel, including Dr. Bud Higgins, Chief of Emergency Services at Maine Med, Dr. Tony Tomasoni, a new Cape resident who is a clinical toxicologist at the Poison Control Center. We will also have Day One represented and Ingram represented. Chief Pickering will be represented, well, we expect Chief Pickering to be there, as well as new CLO officer Gaspar and Sergeant Tubbs. We are using this as a jump off to seek the legislation to heighten awareness throughout the state in a program that can be replicated in other towns throughout the state, and we hope that you will join us in this effort. If you have any questions, I would be more than happy to try and answer them now. I've also included my business card, so you can contact me at a more convenient time for yourselves, if that's appropriate.
Okay. Councilor Cogsell?
Yes. Are you planning to televise this or tape it for a reason?
We are going to be in contact with CETV and ask them to tape this so that the tape can be used for people who cannot attend, because unfortunately we do conflict with the first night of Hanukkah, which is unfortunate, but and we also have a Pond Cove parents meeting that night, so we are going to have it taped.
Very good. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Councilor Linnell?
Yeah. Well, it sounds like you've really done your homework, and I certainly appreciate all your efforts. And I just wanted to, could you say again where the December 5th meeting is? Who is invited? I assume the public of all ages is invited, and just where it is?
Yes, the meeting will take place at 7 p.m. at the middle school cafeterium. All residents of Cape Elizabeth are, of course, invited. We are also inviting the town council, the school board, the administrators and teachers at our schools. Our state legislators have indicated that they will be there, as since this meeting will sort of take the form of a public testimony on legislation. We are also inviting representatives of all of the towns in the greater Portland area, both at the state and local level, the police departments, their offices, and anyone else involved in substance abuse.
Thank you.
Councilor McGinty?
I'd also like to commend Mr. Sweeney for the work he's been doing. I publicly apologize for not getting back to him due to, I guess you're out of town and I was out of town and haven't been able to hook up, but certainly commend you for your effort. And certainly I stand behind you 100% in what you're trying to do.
This is a coalition effort, and we really want to put forward Cape Elizabeth at the leading edge of addressing this issue.
Okay. Anybody else? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Is there anybody else for citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda this evening? Seeing none, we will proceed to the agenda. First of all, we're starting out with a public hearing on a November ballot issue to fluoridate the public water supply. This is a time for the public to speak to this issue. It is not a time for council debate. The council voted a number of months ago to include this item on the ballot for November. If there's anybody in the audience who would like to speak to this, this is your time to do so. Would you please come to the microphone and give us your name and address?
Madam Chairwoman, fellow council members, and citizens of Cape Elizabeth, my name is James Ortengren. I'm a practicing dentist in South Portland. I live in Cape Elizabeth. I come before you this evening as the co-chairman of Citizens for Better Dental Health, a grassroots organization that has initiated this referendum question that we'll all be voting on November 5th. I would like to present you and the citizens of Cape Elizabeth some reasons why one should vote to adjust the level of fluoride to the optimal concentration to prevent tooth decay. 200 years ago, a wise man once said, "An ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure." If Benjamin Franklin had known about fluoridation, I'm sure he would have described it in this way. Community water fluoridation is the single most effective public health measure to prevent dental disease in children and adults. It benefits everyone in the community, regardless if they see a dentist or not, regardless if they are rich or poor. It does not discriminate. Drinking optimally fluoridated water will reduce dental decay, or caries is the medical terminology, up to 40%, thereby reducing pain, discomfort, and tooth loss. Numerous studies have shown that fluoride remineralizes and repairs the beginnings of decay and reduces root surface decays, reduces root surface decay in adults with receding gum line. The facts are clear. Fluoride saves smiles. In 1996, the national average for a small silver filling was about $55. The cost of providing fluoride drops and tablets is about $25 per child per year, and these must be taken daily to be effective. The Portland Water District estimates the cost of providing fluoride will only add 16 cents to your water bill per month for your family and yourself to be protected, everyone in your household. Taxpayers will save as well. Last year, the state of Maine Medicaid program paid out $800,000 to dentists to repair or extract diseased teeth in children in the state of Maine. Fewer decayed teeth means fewer tax dollars spent on state and local subsidized care. Businesses will save as well. Lower decay rates translates eventually, not immediately, but eventually into lower dental insurance premiums because of fewer dental needs by the employees and their families. The facts are clear. Fluoride saves money. Fluoride is found naturally. It's a naturally occurring mineral in almost all water sources and almost all foods. Fortifying water with fluoride has been proven safe and effective in communities across the United States for one half of a century. In Maine, 64 utilities provide fluoridated water to 105 Maine towns. The first was Norway in 1952. Currently, Maine makes fluoridated water available to 27% of its population as compared to a national average of 54%. After the referendum passes, which I'm sure it will, the Portland Water District that number will raise to 60% of our population, thereby reaching Maine's year 2000 health goal. And the facts are clear again. Fluoride is proven safe and effective. Healthy bodies and minds cannot be truly healthy without proper nutrition. One cannot have proper nutrition without healthy functioning teeth. The mouth is the gateway to the body, and the smile is the window on your personality. A diseased mouth with missing teeth not only affects your self-esteem, but also affects how others view you. A healthy smile makes a good impression. The facts are clear. Fluoride ensures overall good health. Now is the time for the people of Greater Portland to get the benefit from this proven health measure. Please vote yes on the issue November 5. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. Is there anybody else from the audience who would like to speak?
Hi, my name is Steve Blumenthal. I'm a pediatrician and I live in Cape Elizabeth. I work in Portland. My interest in this is both as a pediatrician and as a parent of four young children. I think it's essential that we do get fluoride in the water. It's got decades-long record of safety. The current issues of cost-effectiveness weigh greatly in its favor. The American Academy of Pediatrics, of which I am a member, is also strongly supportive of this move to fluoridate water in our communities. So I'd like to make a point that the medical community likewise is behind it. And anybody who is a parent, grandparent, aunt, or uncle would do well by children to support this measure. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Is there anybody else? Seeing none, we will close the public hearing. Thank you very much. On to our items that were tabled from last month's marathon meeting that we had. We have one, two, four, five items from the Pedals and Pedestrian Committee report. First of these, item number 61, is a vote on recommendations of the Pedals and Pedestrian Committee to place a sidewalk on Shore Road from Fort Williams Park to Dyer Pond Road. Counselor Cogswell?
Yes, I move that we remove the items from the table.
Second.
All five of them?
All five.
Okay. All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you very much. On item 61, Mr. McGovern, do you have any comments on that?
I wasn't expecting you to recognize me, but I will. For the council's discussion, there was a proposed agenda item that suggested that perhaps we don't need a sidewalk on Shore Road, that we've got a park right there, and people could walk inside the park. And it suggested that the Fort Williams Advisory Commission review pedestrian opportunities within Fort Williams Park near Shore Road, as well as to review the condition of pedestrian entryways into the park from Shore Road. As Fort Williams faces the community from Shore Road, some of our entrances are not the best. Mrs. Wheatland spoke of one pedestrian entrance that isn't well-marked, and there's others. And just for them to look at it, decide if it's appropriate to do something with those entryways. Report back to the council.
Thank you. Any thoughts, comments? This is not what the P2 committee recommended. This is something different. Counselor Reed?
I personally think, having served as a member of the P2 committee, that any discussion tonight regarding the collector road sidewalks or the sidewalk along Shore Road are premature and inappropriate at this time. And I would like to see if the Fort Williams Advisory Commission, if it's the will of the town council, to review the pedestrian opportunities within Fort Williams, by all means do it. But I think they're working on some other issues that may have more prominence in the community now and more importance. But I just think that in light of some of the decisions that we've made recently, that this sidewalk on Shore Road near Fort Williams is not nearly as necessary now as others thought in the context of the P2 committee.
Okay.
You want a motion?
That would help move things along. You want a motion to take, put it back on the table?
I would like a motion to make a motion to put item 61. Could I say and 65? Or do you want
no,
to separately?
No, we're not there yet.
Item 61 back on the table indefinitely.
Second motion.
There's no discussion of the tabling motion. All those in favor? All those opposed? 6-1. McGinty opposed? Thank you. Item number 65 is a vote on a recommendation of the Pedal and Pedestrian Committee to install sidewalks on certain collector roads. Those collector roads being Scott Dyer Road, Fowler Road, Ocean House Road. Oh, I'm not doing this properly. Scott Dyer Road from Brentwood Road to Spurwink Ave. Fowler Road from Jewett Road to Ocean House Road. Ocean House Road in a couple of locations, from Lyons Field to Mitchell Road, and from Spurwink Ave to the South Portland municipal line. Spurwink Avenue from Maxwell's Farm Market to Ocean House Road, and the entire length of Wells Road. Mr. McGovern, do you want to?
This is a recommendation from the committee. Okay. I wouldn't comment any further on that.
All right. Councilor Cogswell?
Yes, I believe that this is also premature for us to try to authorize these sidewalks. I appreciate all the work that the committee did on these projects. I would like to make a motion that would delay any consideration until we do have a public forum with citizens and town council and staff before any funding is done. If you'd like, I'll make a motion.
Please, as part of that motion to take Wells Road out of the
yes,
item.
It would be to eliminate Wells Road, and the reason why, we also have a separate item coming up dealing with that, but we already have existing in our road ordinances dealing with a sidewalk on that particular road if one is in installed. It's not exactly directly connected to the road, it's an off-road. And I don't know if the P2 committee saw that information or not. So what, I'll move, ordered the Cape Elizabeth Town Council hereby directs the town manager to consider in the next five-year drainage improvement plan a proposed schedule of implementation for the following sidewalk projects on one side of the road. Going through the list but eliminating Wells Road, I'll give this to you, Debbie. A public forum for each project shall be held with the town council, citizens, and staff to determine the desirability of the project prior to any approval of funding. So at least we have this information available, but we're not committed to it until we're sure that it is a good project.
Do we have a second?
I'll second with a question first.
Certainly.
However, does that mean that whenever any drainage improvement or roadway improvement plan on these areas is being done, this will be included at that time?
That is, yeah, that's what this says.
Well, I mean, there's one on Fowler Road coming right up.
I'm going to respond to that.
Yes, I think you should.
Yeah, what it means, as I understand Councilor Cogswell's motion, is that before we went ahead with any plan on any of these roads, we would first hold a forum with the citizen, staff, and council to see if these are improvements on these particular roads that the residents of the area desire.
Right.
We wouldn't go ahead and plan them or do them before we checked very early on with the citizens in the area.
Okay, but what I was asking is, will these public forums on these areas be done in time for when there's a major improvement going on that it will be?
Very early.
Yeah, it says prior to any funding for drainage projects on these roads.
I just think that that's very important in light of the work that the P2 committee has.
To make sure.
That was their intent.
I think it's something that the council, through the manager, needs to stay on top of, and it may lengthen the process a bit, but in the long run, it sounds like it would be a better product. Councilor Linnell?
Yeah, I think it's a good idea, and I would like to suggest there might be two changes, though, before I would vote for it. And one is, I'm wondering, first of all, I'd like to see Mitchell Road included there. Wasn't that long ago, there were a lot of people on Mitchell Road that were concerned about safety of their children on Mitchell Road, and so I'd like to see Mitchell Road come second to, you know, right after Fowler Road, or near the top of the list. And so I'd like to, I would ask the motions to consider including, putting Mitchell Road in there. I know it's mentioned in the next item, but I'd like to see it up top. And also, I think might be a little premature to make the decision that the sidewalk would be just on one side of the road. I wonder if we could, people willing to strike that language, and that's, those kinds of issues could be brought out at the public hearing. I know that it's, from some of the recent exercises we went through, that it's a safety issue if you have a sidewalk on just one side of the road, because that, then it behooves everyone, including small children, to cross the road to get on the sidewalk. So I don't know what the answer is, but I'm suggesting that that we save that for the public hearing.
Before you make an amendment, I'd like to hear both from the manager and Councilor Reed their thoughts on both of those. Councilor Reed, having served on the P2 committee, that was one of the specific recommendations of the P2 committee, was that the sidewalk be on one side of the road. Could you enlighten us, please?
Well, I think the nature of collector roads are that they're small. I mean, and they were trying to preserve as much of the current character as possible without being a burden to the road.
And Mitchell Road is not a collector road?
That's correct.
That's why?
I don't know.
It is?
I believe there's, I believe Mitchell Road was excluded because of safety issues, and the right-of-way is not wide enough during certain parts of the road, especially at some of the turns.
I misspoke. Mitchell Road is listed in the following item as a collector road. Okay. Mr. McGovern, any thoughts on the one sidewalk versus two, and then any thoughts on Mitchell Road being included in the list?
On the first issue, it's really a policy issue on whether or not you would want to bring to the citizens the possibility of one or two sides. That's up to the council. And on the second, whether or not you want to include Mitchell Road, you know, this is presented on the agenda as the recommendation from the committee as to what roads they considered after a year-long process. You know, certainly it's within the council's purview to add or delete any road that you desire.
Thank you. Councilor Jordan?
Maybe I'm a little thick, but as I understand, 65 speaks of sidewalks, and 66 speaks of two-foot shoulders.
Yes, sir.
So there's a difference here, in my opinion, on whether you want a two-foot shoulder on Mitchell Road or a sidewalk, and I would think a two-foot shoulder would be adequate. That's maybe why it's down there. I don't know. Mm-hmm. I think they got to do some thinking here on where they want the shoulders and where they want the sidewalk.
Apparently, that's the process that the P2 committee went through, because they included Mitchell Road for the shoulders and not for the sidewalk. Councilor Linnell?
Again, I think as a policy issue, I think it would be just based on the constituents that I've heard from, I think they would like to have Mitchell Road on the up in that list. And as a policy issue, I think it would be fair to bring to the people the possibility of sidewalks on one or both sides of the road. I think that would be, as a policy issue, I'd like to see that there. I have no idea how I would vote on that issue.
Why don't you make two separate amendments? We can vote on them separately.
Okay. Well, I would, my amendment would be to, just as the identical to the one that's on, that is before us, except I would strike the language on one side of the road and add Mitchell Road to the list.
Do you want to put that into two amendments, keep it as one?
I'm sorry. First Amendment, on one side of the road.
All right. Is there a second?
Strike that language, one side of the road.
Is there a second to the motion?
I'd second.
To the amendment?
I'd second that amendment.
Okay. Discussion? Councilor Jordan?
Well, I can't sit here and vote that I would say I wanted sidewalks on both sides of the road, because I didn't see a road here that I thought was out in the country, but it's coming high up on the list. That one side of the road, in my opinion, would be adequate. As they speak about an agenda item here a little farther along, where possible, and I think that might pertain to most any road where possible. And I don't think you really need them on both sides of the road. I think one side would be adequate for any of the roads.
Thank you. Councilor McGinty.
As I understand what the original motion is, and as amended, what we're talking about is having public hearings before we do anything, before we spend any money, before we decide exactly what we're going to do in regard to sidewalks on these particular roads. Am I correct in that thinking? And that's
the original motion.
What the amendment does is basically say we can discuss either way, not that we make a decision now, but that we can discuss that in public hearing and then make a decision, one side, both sides, neither side, whatever we want to do.
Thank you. Any further discussion on the amendment? All those in favor? All those opposed? 5-2, the amendment carries. Your second amendment, please.
My second amendment would be to include Mitchell Road in the proposed schedule for the public hearing.
Thank you. Is there a second?
I have a question.
No, we can't discuss it, Leah. Do we have a second? You want to second it so you can discuss it?
Oh, second.
Thank you. Now you may discuss it.
From where to where on Mitchell Road, please? From Oakhurst to 77, from Sawyer to 77?
Well, I guess I would certainly think that in the Ledgemere area,
that would be
but I think we might as well, if it's a public hearing, I think We should look at the length of it. I think people, I'd hate to exclude it, anyone, on that issue, and I think it would serve the public to get some feedback. And I know that some of that feedback may make it a long evening, but I think that's what we're here for, and I'd like to, you know, remember, we just went through with Mitchell Road, there were some big concerns there, so. I guess I'd say the length of Mitchell Road, unless someone had some better suggestion.
Okay, you're saying the entire length of Mitchell Road, then. Counselor Groth?
I'm going to vote against this amendment, because I think obviously, a number of meetings over a long period of time, and there's recommendations in front of us. I think they're well-thought-out recommendations, and I'm not going to sit here in the last moment and second-guess. I think when we look down for paving shoulders and collector roads, Mitchell Road is listed there. It's not listed for this input process, this public hearing process for sidewalks, and I'm just not going to second-guess a year's worth of meetings at this late date.
Thank you. Anybody else? Counselor Linnell?
I'll just add, the P2 committee's efforts are noble, and I certainly applaud them, but I see that to some degree on some of these issues as a starting place. And so that's why I'll support this, because I think it's just a beginning.
Okay. All those in favor of the motion, of the amendment? All those opposed? 1-6, amendment fails. Is there any further discussion on the main motion or further amendments? Main motion as amended is what was in the council packet, plus the fact that it does not limit it to one side of the road, plus having a public forum with citizens, staff, and town council for each project prior to any funding being approved. That's the summary of the motion, Councilor Cogswell.
And I eliminated Wells Road.
And eliminated Wells Road. Very important. Thank you. All those in favor, Councilor Linnell?
If at this public hearing, when these other roads are discussed, is there anything to prevent the public citizens from raising questions about the Mitchell Road also?
Probably not. Public hearing, we listen to all sorts of things.
Thank you.
All those in favor of the motion as amended? All those opposed? 6-1, Linnell opposed. Thank you. Item number 66. Is a vote upon the recommendation of the Pedal and Pedestrian Committee to provide paved shoulders on various collector roads. This is, the recommendation is to do give cost estimates to add 2-foot shoulders on both sides of the following roads: Fowler Road from Route 77 to Route 77, excuse me, Old Ocean House Road, Spurwink Avenue, Scott Dyer Road, Mitchell Road, Sawyer Road, Eastman Road, Trendy Road to Katahdin Road, Broad Cove Road to Ledgewood Road, and Cottage Farms Road. We have a motion, Councilor Cogswell?
Yes, I guess I want to ask Rosemary, since she was on the committee. Would you feel that perhaps if we made a reference to stabilize 2-foot shoulders within the right-of-way? Because we do have shoulders as they are now, and they're just gravel.
Correct.
You want
this
something
is
that's more...
This is paved.
You want paved shoulders. Okay.
It needs to be specified.
And Steve Simons is now present. So.
Thank you. I did catch that.
Thank you,
sir. Can I make a motion?
You want me to read this? Okay. The Cape Elizabeth Town Council does hereby resolve that as the following roads are improved, staff should provide to the Town Council cost estimates to add 2-foot paved shoulders on both sides of the roads as listed by our chairman.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Thank you. Discussion? Councilor Jordan.
Yeah, I just have a comment on Scott Dyer Road, I think, has a sidewalk pretty well down at Longfellow Drive. There is a stretch between there and that isn't, doesn't have a sidewalk, and then there's one there by the nursing home that comes up pretty well. I should think Scott Dyer Road should have a sidewalk and not come up with a two-foot paved shoulder for the rest of the road. I think a sidewalk should be there. Hillway has a sidewalk on one side, and I don't know what a two-foot shoulder's going to do on the other side to help it out. They should cross over and go to the sidewalk. I just feel those two roads are out of place.
Councilor McGinty?
I'd like to see this motion amended to include a public hearing on this item also as they come up. I don't know why on 65 we're going to have a public hearing to add sidewalks, but if we're going to add two-foot shoulders, we're not going to have a public hearing to talk about it. I'd like to see if we could amend that to have a similar language prior to financing, we'd have a public hearing to discuss the particular issue.
Did you just make an amendment?
If, yes.
Thank you.
Second.
Thank you. You have that language in the last Ditto, ditto. Discussion on the amendment. Councilor Graff?
I think the amendment is an entirely different issue. All that this particular resolution is that prior to improving the following roads, the staff is simply instructed to find out the cost to add a two-foot shoulder on both sides of the road. That's all. So there's no resolution to do it. All it is to put into the package when we look at road improvement to have additional information available to us. And that's all this motion does. So I find that your amendment at this point in time inappropriate for this particular motion because it's not even down that road yet.
It's the same as the previous one. It was just the program of a proposed schedule, and we've completely changed that around. That's all all 65 was before, that a proposed schedule.
I
and this is the same thing to provide cost estimates. So,
Councilor Jordan?
Councilor Graff took some of my thunder, as you might say, because I agree with him 100%. As I understand this motion, all it is for the town or the public works director, somebody, the engineer, to look into the possibilities of when they repave a road, one of these that's mentioned here, they look into the possibilities of adding 2 feet to the paving job.
Councilor Cogsell?
I agree with Councilor Graff. The impact of a 2 foot paved shoulder on the side is nowhere nearly as severe as a sidewalk, and it's well within the purview of the town and the highway department to feel they need to reinforce the actual travel area of the highway. So I don't think it really pertains to this particular motion.
Councilor McGinty?
I withdraw my amendment to expedite this.
Comment from that?
Mr. McGovern?
I just want to reassure anyone who lives on any of these roads that prior to proposing anything would have a neighborhood meeting, not a public hearing, because that's another whole thing, but a real informal invite people, meet in the cafeteria or whatever, and give us your views on what ought to be done.
There's good precedent for that. We did that with Sawyer Road.
A whole bunch of projects, yeah. Most everyone.
And I remember attending that one and having good discussion. Thank you for that reminder. Councilor Linnell?
Yes, it seems to me whether it were a sidewalk or a shoulder, it's certainly still within the right-of-way and so forth. I'm wondering if the possibility of a sidewalk, pardon the pun, down the road sometime, might be impacted by the decision to put a two-foot shoulder, I don't know. So I guess making those comments, I'd just like to suggest another amendment to, while they're looking at cost estimates for a two-foot shoulder, would it not...
make it in the form of amendment, please, so
right.
We can vote on it.
My amendment would be to include possibility of sidewalks along, while they're doing the estimates for the shoulder, for the two-foot shoulder, to estimate a sidewalk.
Are you talking sidewalk on one or two sides of the roads?
Well, I think it would be appropriate to look at both, and you can strike one. While we're, it just seems prudent to me, while we're looking, if we're looking at estimates to do shoulders, we might see what the difference would be to add a sidewalk. So therefore, that's, my motion would be to include sidewalk estimates on both sides.
Thank you. Do we have a second to that amendment? Amendment fails for lack of a second. Councilor Coxell?
I move the question.
Thank you. All those in favor of the original motion with no amendments? All those opposed? 6-1, Linnell. Thank you. Item number 67. Excuse me. Mr. Simons, are you going to stay for a little while? A little while? Okay. Thank you. Let me just get through our tabled items. Excuse me. Item number 67, a vote upon the recommendation of the Pedal and Pedestrian Committee to provide paved shoulders on the entire length of Wells Road. The recommendation was for paved shoulders on both sides. Is this recommendation taken straight from the report?
Yeah, but it was unsure.
Okay,
the footage was uncertain.
Two to four foot shoulders on both sides except of Wells Road, except where homes are within 20 feet of the road or stone walls would be within 5 feet of the shoulder, is the recommendation from the P2 committee. Councilor Jordan?
Just wondered if you felt that I'd have a conflict of interest on this, where I live on Wells Road.
I don't think you have a conflict on financial grounds. Are you unbiased enough to deal with this fairly in your mind?
I think I can deal with it fairly, but I just don't want anybody to have any questions in their mind about how I'd vote.
Thank you. Any councilors have any problems with Councilor Jordan participating? We expect you to fully participate, Councilor. Thank you. Councilor McGinty?
I make a motion. When Wells Road is next reconstructed, 4 foot shoulders shall be provided on both sides except where homes are within 20 feet of the road or stone walls would be within 5 feet of the shoulder.
Councilor Reed?
I'll second that with a comment.
All right.
It was 4 feet. That was the intention of the P2 committee. Is that correct, Steve? 4 feet was the intention of the P2 committee.
Okay. Councilor Coxell?
Yes, I'd like to amend this so that a public forum is held with town council, citizens who live along that road, and staff before any funding is approved for this project, as we did with the others.
Do we have a second on the amendment? Councilor Linnell, you're seconding?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Discussion on the amendment? Councilor Reed?
I have a question. Since there is a major project that will be going on along Shore Road, which my understanding will include about 8 feet of roadway that has to be moved for sewerage.
You mean Wells Road? Or Shore
Wells,
Road?
I'm sorry.
Thank you, Councilor Groff.
Wells Road. Thank you. I would like to know, are we suggesting that this might be a project that the someone other than the town shares the cost in? And how would that be handled?
Mr. McGovern?
The discussion on improvements to Wells Road following the anticipated construction of the Dominicus Crossing subdivision and the sewer line and other related improvements is that they would contribute into a fund the cost of our estimated cost of full width reconstruction of the existing road. We've, I forget the exact amount, but we've agreed to an amount to do that based on some estimates we've gotten. The town would undertake the project to be sure that it was done the way we wanted to do in terms of the lower level. And it's been quite a bit of time. Have I misspoken at all, Mr. Dewan?
I'm afraid
yeah. So it would be part of the discussion when we resolve, in the end, the exact amount that we determine for Wiles Road be a matter of discussion and negotiation. We're pretty close to an agreement. You know, when you're reconstructing something anyway, the cost is minimal just to add a little bit of width. It gets expensive if you go in and you try to do it. You know, there had been talk, the P2 committee originally recommended that they put a sidewalk along there in exchange for that. Dominicus Crossing is actually constructing a basketball court up on the property. So, you know, there's been a lot of give and take on that. We'll have a chance to discuss that later a little bit more.
Okay. Councilor Coxell.
Yes, I cannot vote for this proposal as presented with a 4-foot width. The Wells Road area is considered to be one of our most scenic roads in town and was rated very high in the visual assets assessment report that was done in 1988. And a 4-foot paved shoulder is equivalent to an older generation of bike path. And I just think it would be quite detrimental to the whole character of that particular road. A 2-foot paved shoulder would make it more passable, but I think 4 feet is detrimental, I guess, is what I want to say.
Thank you. Councilor McGinty.
I would like to save our successor councils down the road from going through what we went through last month on the Shore Road issue. And that is that Dominicus Crossing is going to be built. I think we all realize that was 98 homes, 97 homes. There's going to be children who want to get to school. The only way for them to get there is down Wells Road. We have an opportunity when the road is reconstructed with the sewer line to put in the 4-foot wide shoulders now, so that we don't have the big battle down the road 5 years from now or whenever that project will be fully built out, but that it's going to happen, and our successor council shouldn't have to go through what we went through last month. And so that's why I'm supporting the 4-foot wide shoulders now. I have the same concerns that Councilor Coggeshall has. However, we don't know what's going to happen with the Jordan and Layton property there. For all we know, we'll have another 100 homes there down the road. We might as well do it now while it won't be as expensive in either a motion or in tax dollars to get it done.
Thank you. Councilor Coxell.
I just want to repeat what I had said earlier, that already existing in ordinances that deal with this road as a rural connector and not a regular connector is an accommodation for a sidewalk that is not tied directly to the highway itself. It's just off, so there's a little bit of a buffer between the road and the sidewalk, so you still have more of a feeling that you're not walking in the middle of a highway. And I would hate to see us completely ignore something that's already been approved. If we could amend this to include that as part of the consideration, that might be more acceptable, but then we have not voted on the amendment to hold a public hearing on this issue either. So that could be brought up in a public hearing format.
Mm-hmm. Councilor Linnell?
I think, again, the timing is everything here, and there is an opportunity here while the work is being done to do something here. So I will tend to support it. I'm just lamenting that there's also a lot of there's a lot of kids also on Mitchell Road, and I think I'd like to see a little more attention there, but I'll tend to support this.
We have an amendment being discussed. The amendment is to hold a public hearing. Councilor Jordan?
Well, my only point to it, I don't think you need it on both sides of the road due to the way the houses are there now are situated. You go up part of the road, and then if you're going to take somebody's doorstep, you can get your 4 feet. If you're not, then they got to cross over onto the other side if they're going to stay on a sidewalk. I think some thought should be put in as far as saying both sides of the road.
Thank you. I share a previous councillor's comment on the concern with the 4-foot shoulders on both sides of the road. I approach this in similar fashion to my thought processes for our discussions last month on Two Lights Road and on Shore Road, I'm quite surprised at the, that there's not more discussion about the scenic quality of Wells Road than when there was so much discussion about that on Shore Road. I need to know how this is going to impact the road with 4-foot wide shoulders before I can vote for that width of shoulder. I would be much more comfortable saying 2 to 4 feet wide, and I need to see it out graphically, basically, before I know what the impacts are, before I can make this kind of decision. I would be comfortable having a public forum for discussion when that kind of information is available, but absent that, I'm not going to be supporting this. Councilor McGinty?
Is there not an amendment on the floor to add in a public hearing?
There is a public hearing, but it still says 4-foot shoulders. That part was not amended. Councilor Linnell?
Again, I think that the size is an issue that could be shaken out at the public hearing. So, and some of the scenic qualities, those issues could be, I would think, be raised there too. So I'll tend to support it.
Thank you. Councilor Reed?
I just wanted to point out, I know we can all read, it says, except where homes are within 20 feet of the road or stone walls would be within 5 feet of the shoulder. So that in and of itself gives flexibility on the 4 feet. But the my understanding of the intent was that you would go in there thinking that 4 feet were appropriate and narrowing when you had to, based on this language.
Unfortunately, I am not as well acquainted with Wells Road as I am, say, with Shore Road, and I don't know exactly where that would be. Councilor Coxall?
Yes, I'm asking Councilor McGinty if he'd be willing to amend his motion to give us a 2-to-4-foot range instead of a flat 4.
Okay, before we get into that, let's vote on the current amendment on the floor. Could we have that read back, please, Ms. Lane? Just to remind us.
It would be, the amendment would be to include a public forum for the project on Wells Road to be held with the town council, citizens, and staff to determine the desirability of the project prior to any approval of funding.
Thank you. Councilor Jordan?
Does that mean it couldn't go be included within the hearing as far as overall plan of what's being done? Why can't that be? Why do we need a separate one?
Mr. McGovern?
Yeah. You know, when if we're going down to take a project on Wells Road, which, you know, apparently with Dominica's Crossing's ultimate approval coming up, we'll be doing, no matter what, we'd want to have a meeting early on with everyone who owns property on Wells Road, just explaining to them the scope of the project, what's going to happen, how it's going to affect them, all those things that we usually do at those meetings. And, you know, at that point in time, you know, very, you know, we could do it within the next month or so. We could, you know, ask people, what do you think about this? You know, and this is one of the things being considered, and the council, you know, would be invited to the meeting as well. It wouldn't be a, you know, it'd be very informal. People wouldn't be on TV. People can say whatever they want, and you know, those councilors who are able to attend, find those that aren't, would, you know, get the notes of the meeting, and then you'd make a judgment thereafter as to what you wanted to do. If this motion amendment was approved, so that's the way it would be done. And if amendment wasn't approved, we'd still have a neighborhood meeting on the rest of the issues of the project, and just say this was already voted and this is going to happen.
Can't do things together. We got to do them separately.
No, we, no matter what we do, we, you know, if council approves anything, we would do it at the same time we're doing this other work. This makes sense.
Okay. All those in favor of the amendment? All those opposed? 6-1, Jordan?
And 6-1 all night, I wanted to keep it that way.
Appreciate the consistency.
Madam Chair?
Yes,
would it help matters if I amended my original motion?
It's too late, I think.
No, I think we're going to have a record for amendments this evening.
Hope Dole and Clinton are doing better than we are.
Probably more people are watching.
Watching us?
to strike 4 foot, I'll just repeat the motion, as when Wells Road is reconstructed, shoulders shall be provided except where homes are within 20 feet of the road or stone walls would be within 5 feet of the shoulder, and the public hearing shall be held, whatever that amendment was.
Don't they paved shoulders?
It didn't say paved before. I think that's what we're...
Okay.
But should it say paved?
It should have said paved.
Then, and add paved shoulders. And that way we can leave it totally open for the public discussion on whether it's two, it's four, it's none, it's both sides, it's one side. We can discuss that, flesh that all out at a public hearing.
Are you making a new major motion? Say yes. Just say yes.
Yes.
Second.
Thank you. All those in favor? All those opposed?
I just wanted to clarify what he motioned.
Mm-hmm.
You are eliminating both sides.
Both sides. I'm eliminating that.
All right. Fine.
7-0, right?
Your hand was up. 7-0. Mm-hmm. Let's not even do that one again. Thank you.
No.
Item number 68, vote upon a recommendation of the Pedestrian Pedestrian Committee relating to the Greenbelt facilities. The recommendations are that the town should acquire easements to construct multi-use trails that connect various parts of town with the town center, easterly, central, and westerly routes. Priority will be given to the easterly route that will connect Fort Williams Park with the town center via Dia Pond Road. The town should explore opportunities to increase its support of the Conservation Commission. Options could include a plan to change tax treatment of land on which connecting easements for future multi-use trails are located, or a plan for additional police protection for motorized vehicle use of the trails. The town should publish a map using the GIS system to accurately portray town-owned land, conservation easements, constructed greenbelt trails, planned greenbelt trails, bikeways, and sidewalks. Councillor Reed, is that verbatim from the committee?
Pretty close.
Verbatim.
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 I'm assured.
I'm hearing verbatim.
That's verbatim.
From this side. Councillor Groff?
I'm just a little confused with the first part of that. The town of Cape Elizabeth should acquire easements. I don't know what that means. I mean, I would be much happier with language to the effect the town of Cape Elizabeth should explore the acquisition of easements. I just don't know what should acquire easements means. I think it's poor drafting.
Do you want to make a motion?
I don't think we have a formal motion on
not
the table
yet.
You can make it.
Well, I can certainly make it, but perhaps other people have other, before we make a motion as to the whole package, someone else has some other comments.
Good idea.
So we don't go through an amendment process?
Councillor Linnell.
I agree with Councillor Groff on that one. And that's my primary comment.
All right, thank you. Councillor Reed.
Mine, regardless of where anybody stood on the issue of how to get from town center to Shore Road, on what mode to use or whatever, many people talked about in the questionnaires as well as in the committee that there should be a connection to it. So this is one way to provide it without putting in paved shoulders or sidewalks, is to increase and connect many of the linkages that we currently have. And that's why this language came forward, even if it weren't necessarily perfect language.
Thank you. Can we have a motion, please? Councillor Groff?
Sure. Resolved, the Cape Elizabeth Town Council endorses the following recommendations of the Pedestrian Pedestrian Committee. The town of Cape Elizabeth should explore the acquisition of easements to construct multi-use trails that connect various parts of town with the town center, the easterly, central, and westerly routes. Priority will be given to the easterly route that will connect Fort Williams Park with the town center via Dyer Pond Road. The town should explore opportunities to increase its support of the Conservation Commission. Options could include a plan to change tax treatment of land on which connecting easements for future multi-use trails are located, or a plan for additional police protection from motorized vehicle use of the trails. The town should publish, when able, and I'm inserting when able, a map using the GIS system to accurately portray town-owned land, conservation easements, constructed greenbelt trails, planned greenbelt trails, bikeways, and sidewalks.
Second.
Thank you. Any discussion? Councilor Jordan.
I just have one comment. When some of these people in the past have given land to the town for conservation and spoke about a trail, but I think that was for a walking trail. It wasn't a motorized trail. How are these people going to take this now? We're going to motorize these walkways from one end of town to the other. We got a road. Why do we need a motorized trail?
I'm not sure there's anything in here that says that we're having a motorized trail. That depends on the language.
That's the next
step. That's an option, Councilor.
The intent of the motion is that the police would patrol and watch these trails so that they were not used for motorized equipment.
I want to see them walk them.
The police?
Yes.
I'll let them know that.
I'll call Pickering tomorrow.
Any further discussion? Thank you. All those in favor of the motion? All those opposed? 7-0. Thank you. That concludes the items that we had tabled last month from the Pedals and Pedestrian Committee report. I beg the council's indulgence before I go on to the next agenda item. I did have a phone call and discussion recently with Steve Simons, a former councillor and state representative, who has three visitors with him this evening from Brazil. They are here under the sponsorship of the Partners of the Americas. Would you like to introduce your guests to the audience, if you'd like to bring them up to the podium?
No.
Well, if you'd like to.
I'm afraid.
Only if you want to.
Right. Well, thank you for recognizing us, Madam Chair and Council. I appreciate this opportunity to introduce our three guests from the partner state for Maine. Maine has a partner state in Brazil, the state of Rio Grande do Norte. We've been in, had this partnership among volunteers, and it is a volunteer organization, for nearly 30 years. A number of cooperative projects have taken place over time, and this time we have two people here on projects, and I will introduce them and tell you briefly what the project is. And then a third person with us is a journalist. But first, with the vice president of our partners organization in Brazil, is Daisy Leite.
Hi.
Hi. I want to use some English. yes. And this is Gisele Stoudahar, who is a member of Partners, and Mr. List Madruga, all from the city of Natal. Gisele Stoudahar is on a project called Sustainable Development, looking at ways to balance economy, economic development, the environment, and social issues. Kind of approach. And my friend Daisy Leite is here to look at the way citizens participate in civic affairs. She's under a project called Citizen Participation. And this is one of the reasons we wanted to be here tonight. She wanted to see local democracy in action, and I wanted to show her the most effective council, municipal council in the state of Maine. Mr. Madruga is a journalist and will be recording the activities of our two ladies here, And as you can see, he's busy taking pictures, and you may be on the front page of the Journal in Natal, Rio Grande do Norte. So thank you again for having us.
Maybe I
You want to say something?
Can you
I have
speak?
A question.
Yes.
Or a comment. Gisella, I'm curious. Are you familiar with the work of Donella Meadows?
Oh, Limits of Growth?
Yes.
Yes,
I think she.
I thought perhaps. Okay. She's not too far from here. She's in New Hampshire, I believe.
New Hampshire.
And I've got a card here from, and I'd like to lend this to you. I need it right back. But this is Molly Olson's card. She's on the President's Council on Sustainable Development. Maybe you already know her, but.
Probably.
But
you can write it down and give it back to you. Thank you.
Yes, we're going to thank you. Oh, thanks a lot. I'm pleasure to know here and to know every very nice group, and you work so hard. And my English is not good, but I can say to you that my state and my country was the first state in Brazil that the woman was voting. So, do you understand my English, no?
Yes.
Okay. And thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, I'd like to say good night first and thank all of you. For us, you can believe it's a great opportunity, you know, to share this moment and try to learn something of the way you used to work and try to make this a reality in our country, that we are a little far from this yet, but just a question of time. I hope so. So thank you very nice, very much.
And Mr. We'll translate for you, Madruga.
My name is Lizette Madruga, journalist, Brasilia. I am not speak English. Em Natal, eu sou jornalista, sou editor de turismo, automobilismo e aviação. E sou diretor de comunicação social da Câmara Municipal do Natal.
Yes. Well, Mr. Madruga says that in Natal he is editor of tourism, automobilism and flying. Of the principal newspaper of the city, and he's also the director of our city hall house, you know, and what we call their camera of the vereadores, our municipality, you know, that's what he says. Yes, and he also asked me to thank all of you for your attention and say good night also.
Thank you. Right.
Thank you.
Again.
Thank you.
Good to see you again. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We have a town pin. Steve, we have pins for your other.
Oh.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Just wanted to thank you again for this opportunity. And needless to say, we expect to see you all someday in the great city of Natal and Rio Grande do Norte.
Thank you for joining us this evening. We're doing pretty well with our Southern Hemisphere visitors lately.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. Gisella?
Not right now. Well, good night.
Night.
We'll get back to our hard work. Another item that we had tabled from the September 9th meeting was item number 81, the acceptance of Cape Woods Drive and related easements. Mr. McGovern, do you have any information?
Yeah, this process has been ongoing for a couple of years, but more actively in the last 9 months, the Cape Woods Association has requested that we accept their roads. It's been the past practice of the council when they do meet town standards that we do accept them. I did have some concerns with some of the documentation at the previous meeting, and our attorneys working with their attorneys have squared it all away. I'd recommend that you accept Cape Woods Drive and the related easements in the form in the draft motion.
Thank you. Do you have a motion?
I'll make a motion that we bring 81 from the table.
Thank you, Councilor Jordan. Do I have a second?
Second.
All those in favor of removing it from the table? 7-0. Thank you. Motion on the item?
I'll take a shot at it.
Councilor Linnell?
The Cape Elizabeth Town Council does hereby accept as a public way Cape Woods Drive, and also accepts, but not as a public way, all related easements. The town clerk is to include in the official minutes a copy of the deed description and the easements.
I have a second. Any discussion? All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. We have proposed 7 items on the consent calendar this evening. Are there any items that councilors wish to have removed from the consent? Councilor McGinty.
Madam Chair, I'd like to remove number 85 and number 91.
All right, those will be removed. We'll start with number 85. That's approval of the warrant for November 5th, 1996 election and appointment of student election clerks. Ms. Lane, do you have information for us?
I do. Thank you very much, Madam Chairman. I appreciate you taking this off the consent agenda this evening. One thing I wanted to point out, that the election warrants are the same. It calls for the elections again on Tuesday, November 5th at the high school. In addition to that, we have 2 high school students that I hope, with your approval, will be serving as student election clerks. What that means is that the state law allows for 17-year-olds to assist municipal clerks at the election. Katie Williams and Corrine Minden are 2 high school students. They are seniors who actually have to give at least 18 hours of civic service, and they have chosen to work with me for the election. I think that the town is extremely fortunate to have these young ladies working with us. I think for them, being a presidential year, it'll be a very special experience for them. So I hope that you'll not only approve the election warrants as presented, but approve with enthusiasm our 2 student election clerks.
Thank you. Councilor McGinty.
The only question I really had was the town clerk's memo, she states that she'd asked the two local political committees if they would have any comments by today. And my only question was, were there any comments that came in regarding the student election?
No, there were not.
Okay. That was only my only question.
Okay. Thank you. I also was going to ask that this be removed. We have 8 referenda questions on the ballot in November, and number 8 is a proposed constitutional amendment. This, I'm going to ask the clerk to just say a couple of words about this, knowing that the Clerks Association was the sponsoring entity for this, and what the impact is on our operations.
Okay. Currently, we only have 2 working days to certify petitions that come in. And I think that stipulates it's within 5 days of when the petition is due to the state. Obviously, given the staff that we have, when I say the staff, I mean all over the state, it's very hard to certify petitions within 2 working days. All that we are asking is to have more time to accurately and to certify those petitions. There have been times over the last couple of years where municipal offices have not been able to certify all petitions, or they've had to take them home, they've had to come in on weekends. I know clerks have given up vacations to certify petitions. We're just asking for some reasonable time to be able to certify these. So we really hope that the voters of the state think very carefully when they vote on this. That again, we're just allowing for some reasonable time to be able to certify these.
Thank you very much. Can I have a motion on this item, please? Councilor McGinty.
I move approval of the November 5th general election and special municipal election warrant. I also recommend that we appoint Katie Williams and Corrine Minden to serve as student election clerks for the November 5th, 1996 election.
Second.
Thank you. Further discussion? All those in favor? 7-0. We'll take items 86, 87, 88, 89, and 90 on consent calendar. Item number 86 is approval of the MMA, Maine Municipal Association, 1996 to 1997 officer election ballot. That includes one-year term as president, Michael Roy of Oakland, one-year term as vice president, George Campbell Jr. of Portland, three-year terms as executive committee members, James Collins of Ashland, Margaret Daigle of East Millinocket, William Romano of Hamden, Sandra Altmansberger of Machias, and two-year terms advisory committee members, Howard Gurney of West Paris, Richard Scott of Presque Isle, Lawrence Mitchell of Saco, James Catlin of Brownville, and Lauren Robbins of Chelsea. Also includes voting delegate credentials. I would propose there that we have Janet McLaughlin be designated voting delegate and Phyllis Cogsell as alternate delegate for Cape Elizabeth to the Maine Municipal Association's annual business meeting, 9 a.m., October 24, 1996. Item number 87 is agreement of lease of building 326 at Fort Williams Park. This is a new five-year lease agreement with Day One under the name of Drug Rehabilitation Incorporated. We're coming to the end of their current five-year lease, and the manager has been in negotiations with them, has managed to negotiate an increased revenue in the form of rent over the next 5 years above what it is right now. The rest of the terms appeared to be identical
just
about to what we have now.
The increase in rent, you sort of alluded to it, but you didn't address it. It goes from around $7,000 per year to $25,000 per year in increasing in equal increments over the last 5 years. So we are looking at getting more competitive rents, not only from this property, but as other leases come up at Fort Williams Park.
Thank you. Item number 88 is approval of a conduit location for 9X on Stonegate Road at Mitchell Road. The application is made to provide service to new homes being built on Rock Crest Drive. Item number 89 is approval of an abatement for a veteran's exemption at number 2 Wobbin Road, tax map U12, lot 19. The abatement in the amount of $93. And item number 90 is approval of an abatement review of property valuation at 10 Southwell Road, map U33, lot 7C, an abatement in the amount of $135.78 for fiscal year 96 and $132.75 for fiscal year 1995. Could I have a motion for the consent calendar, please? Councilor Cogsell?
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. All in favor? 7-0. Thank you. We've taken item number 91 off the consent calendar. That is approval of Puputa Club liquor license and special amusement permit. Ms. Lane?
Thank you very much. You do have before you a completed application for the Puputa Club for the renewal liquor license and special amusement permit. James DiOrio, the manager of the Puputa Club, is here if you have any questions. As your council policy indicates, if there are any citizens that have any comments, this would be the time for them to comment as well.
Okay, thank you. Councilor Cogsell.
Yes, I will not be participating in the discussion of this item since my husband is a stockholder in Puputa Club.
Thank you. Councilor Graf.
I'm a stockholder, but I'm not so sure that makes me recuse myself in this particular case because of the unique nature of being a stockholder in Puputic, where you have really no rights except to, I guess I could vote, but I guess I can resign. But other than that, I'm not so sure it makes me very special in the sense of making me recuse myself in this matter. I mean, I guess, Phyllis, if you feel it's necessary, I will too. I simply don't see the legal standard necessary for recusal here, but so be it.
Councilor Linnell?
Of course,
course, you can all also address the perceived conflict by identifying it. You both have identified it, and that may be enough.
Well, before I recuse myself, can I ask why this was removed from the consent agenda?
Councilor McGinty?
The application is not complete.
I'm not going to recuse myself unless I'm instructed to do so by the town's attorney.
Are there any councilors who have a concern with Councilor Groff participating? Seeing none?
Yeah, maybe we ought to have the town attorney look at this. I know, I mean, it comes up all the time, and now with Councilor Groff, maybe that's a good idea. I mean,
sometimes it's after your personal conscience as well.
I would just like...
Councilor McGinty, would you like to elaborate on why you wanted this off consent?
Question number 5 is not complete. And I'd like to know the answer to that. This came up the last time they submitted a liquor license. They left one or two questions unanswered also. And I would just like to see the application complete. I said that the last time, and I guess I say it again this time. I'm not opposed to approval of this. I just want to see a complete application in front of me, that's all.
I'm assuming, Jim, that it is a corporation since the supplementary questionnaire is... Question 5 is applicant a corporation? And asks if it is, if the supplementary questionnaire is attached. And it is attached.
This is the only question paper that we received. We had no supplementary thing from the state.
Jim, is it a corporation?
Yes, it is.
Yes. And that's why that was attached.
Do you have the original?
I'm sorry, I didn't see that.
Yeah, I have the original. Yeah.
If you would come up and complete that right now with the clerk, please. Just come up and check the appropriate information.
Yes, complete supplementary questionnaire.
If the council will note on their copies, please, that item number 5, the answer is yes. It requires that the answer is yes, the supplementary questionnaire be attached, and that is, in fact, attached. Next to the last page, no, 3 pages back, 2 pages back. Any other further questions or concerns, Councilor McGinty?
Just on page 2, B, it asks for place of birth, and place of birth is omitted for that person.
That I don't have.
We can get that before it's sent into the state.
Again, my only issue is I think the application should be complete. If it's going to be deemed complete, it should be complete.
Thank you. Any further questions? Mr. Diorio? We need a motion. Councilor Reid?
Madam Chairman, I move that we approve the Perpudic Club liquor license and special amusement permit.
Can we have a second?
I'll second the motion.
Thank you. I will support this with the understanding that the one missing piece of information is provided on the form before it goes to the state. And that will be a direction to the clerk. Mm-hmm. All those in favor of the motion? 5-2-0-2.
I'll abstain, Billy, since there seems to be some issue whether I should be voting or not.
So what's the latest?
Five in favor, one abstention, one.
Two abstentions.
Two abstentions. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, and sorry for the omission.
Go to new items on the agenda. Item number 92, responses from the Planning Board and the Fort Williams Advisory Commission on the proposed dedication of space within at Fort Williams Park. Mr. McGovern?
The council may recall that at your meeting last month on September 9th, I believe the date was, you requested the Planning Board and the Fort Williams Advisory Commission to report back to you on their suggestions on this proposal no later than this evening. The Fort Williams Committee recommendation you received earlier, the Planning Board recommendation was just finalized last evening at the meeting, so you just have it before you this evening. The standard procedure for an amendment to the zoning ordinance would be to refer it to the Ordinance Committee for review. You may also note in the comments from the Planning Board prepared by Ms. O'Meara is that this is an amendment to the proposed zoning ordinance and not to the existing zoning ordinance. So, you know, therefore, you've got to be very careful in adopting this, that it be done in, that when it is adopted, it be done in such a way that it is actually carrying on to a document that's in existence. And, you know, depending on how you resolve reviewing this over the next month at the Ordinance Committee level, however you do it, we just need to be sure that it's in the proper enactment form so that it is being enacted to the as an amendment to the proper ordinance. It also, just to reiterate, it also includes proposed amendments to the master plan of Fort Williams Park as well, as had been recommended by the working group.
Thank you. I feel we're at a bit of a disadvantage having received the final comments from the Planning Board only this evening in our places. I don't know any substantive changes have been made. I don't believe there have been any substantive changes, but that's something I certainly need to review. Based on our standard operating procedure, I would suggest the council consider forwarding this to the Ordinance Committee. Councilor Reed?
Madam Chairman, I'll make that motion, and I have a question.
I'll second.
Thank you. Your question, Councilor Reed?
In what I've read, there's no incorporation of the Fort Williams Advisory Commission comments, only the Planning Board. Have I got a different copy than everyone else?
I found the same concern. I was looking at it rather late last evening, but I didn't see them in there.
Well, we received the September 19th minutes of the Fort Williams Advisory Commission, which explain in detail what they would like to have done. And I also would like to bring up the point, in reading this language, it reminds me of another neighborhood that abuts the fort, and I would like to know if we could have a discussion about the protection of the Surf Road area at the same time that this is being looked at in the Ordinance Committee for the proposed language.
Councilor Jordan, as chair of the Ordinance Committee, I'd like to hear from you.
What would you like to hear?
I'd like to hear your response, your thoughts on, can the Ordinance Committee endeavor to incorporate the comments, review and incorporate the comments from the Fort Williams Commission, and also consider appropriate language or consideration for the northern part of Fort Williams?
Well, I just received this as I arrived here this evening, and I haven't really read it all over, but I would almost think the proper route for this is to go to the Ordinance Committee so people can, so a guy can get a chance to digest it a little bit. And I think at that same time, Surf Road area of the fort will be brought up.
Thank you, sir. Councilor Cogsell.
I'm concerned with our bringing up the Surf Road area without first running it by the Fort Williams Advisory Committee. I suppose we could discuss it and forward it to them, but we don't have anything in writing from them.
No, I told them I would be bringing it up tonight. They're just waiting to hear from us.
They're waiting to hear from us.
Or the Ordinance Committee, whatever the body is.
It could be that the Ordinance Committee considers meeting with the Fort Williams Advisory Commission. A thought. Councilor McGinty?
As a member of the Ordinance Committee, I'd be concerned about bringing up the Surf Road issue in conjunction with this. This, you know, comes from a lot of hard work from a lot of people trying to resolve the whole Fort Williams Fields issue. And I think we made a commitment to those people that we would deal with this issue and resolve it as quickly as possible. I'm more than willing to look at the Surf Road issue, but not necessarily in conjunction with this. I'd rather see us move this forward, get this done, because it's a byproduct of the fields issue in the first place.
Councilor Reed?
Just to be clear, I did not mean to piggyback them. I just meant, in reading the language and the concerns expressed by the third parties in this, whose comments are clearly in here, it reminded me that there's another side of the park who also has a neighborhood, and they may have similar issues. We just haven't heard from them, and I think it's appropriate, if we agree with the principles set forth here, that we consider it at both sides as a matter of policy.
Councilor Jordan?
I just want to say, I think when the ordinance committee sits down, that they ought to take a look at any section of the fort that would be involved in the way they thought something should be done differently with it. Not necessarily bring it before this. If part of the committee didn't agree with it, maybe the other one would agree. I don't see having a meeting after a meeting on the same section of Cape Elizabeth, that's all. Seems so you could combine things. I know what people's looking for, and I agree with them 100% that it ought to be tied down. But if there's another spot there that could be added to it without creating another hearing and so on and so forth and cover it, I think it should be done. I may get outvoted, but that's okay. I've done that before. So that's my thoughts. I like to do things together and not keep meeting and meeting and meeting for something else. That's all.
Thank you.
So we'll take care of it.
Councilor Graff?
Can I ask a question as a time frame when we would anticipate the ordinance committee looking at this matter and when we could anticipate this coming back to the council?
Next council meeting.
That's great. Thank you.
Is that okay?
That's wonderful. Thank you.
We'll move forward.
If it's an ordinance amendment, it needs a public, needs to be set to public hearing at one meeting and then a public hearing at the subsequent meeting. Is a typical process. If the ordinance committee does come back to the council at the November meeting, it could recommend that a public hearing be set for the December meeting. That December meeting is December. It's going to be another Wednesday. It's going to be December 11th. Pardon me?
Yeah, it is because of the NLC meeting.
We have four councilors out of town. That's the time frame I'm hearing. Councilor Linnell.
Yeah, I think it's appropriate to look at both sides of the park at the same time. I think I don't think it'll delay it unnecessarily or unduly. So I would be in favor of it, and I'd be in favor of having the ordinance committee and Fort Williams Advisory Committee look at it also.
I have no problem.
Okay. All right. The motion is that it be referred to the ordinance committee. All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 93 is a report from the Chief of Police on Shore Road safety. Mr. McGovern?
Yes, I'd like to apologize to the Town Council and to citizens. I had expected that this may be ready this evening. That was, I think, the impression that I had leaving the last meeting. It was not the impression that everyone had. And due to, as I mentioned earlier, the busyness of my schedule, I didn't make known what my impression was in a timely manner to the Chief of Police, so therefore the report's not done. It is being worked on. I've asked the Chief to get me a draft by the beginning of next week. Once that happens, there's some additional issues that would go beyond the public safety aspect of it that I want to address, and the plan would be to have this on the council agenda at the November 13th meeting. So with apologies and, you know, after any opportunity the councils may have that they want to comment on this development, I would suggest that at the appropriate time, a councilor make the motion to table this for the November meeting.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? Thank you. 7-0. Item number 94 is communication from citizens regarding standards for daycare facilities. We are in receipt of what I will call a petition from people calling themselves concerned citizens of Cape Elizabeth, subject day nursery and child care. We consider day nursery and child care a business. We feel as though there should be more regulations on this matter. We request the council look at existing rules and take under consideration the following suggested items. Number one, lot size. Number two, road access. Number three, number of children in a daycare nursery. Number four, number of children in a daycare. Number five, age group in day nursery. Number six, age group in daycare. We trust the council will consider these and other tightening regulations regarding day nurseries and child care. It's signed by one. Citizens. I have had a conversation with the gentleman who initiated this, and what I proposed to him would be that the council was doing some work along these lines with the zoning ordinance rewrite, but that it would not be at all out of line for us to have a forum for discussion with citizens who are interested in this particular topic. I think that would serve us all well, and I would plan to schedule that as soon as we can, I think is what I'd said to him. He was aware of our very busy workshop schedule. It may not be until the next calendar year, but we will try to get it on. I would propose that we try to get it onto the council's discussions with the public as soon as it's viable. But I'm certainly, well, that's the discussion I had with Mr. Cousins. Told him I would present that proposal to the council. I would like to hear from thoughts from other councilors. Council Linnell?
I think that sounds like a fine idea, and I just would ask, would you also think it would be appropriate at this time to refer it to the planning and zoning boards?
I think it would be preferable to have a discussion with the citizens first so we can give direction to the planning board and zoning boards. Councilor Reed?
I was wondering if I could put a member of the zoning board on the spot to ask approximately how many of these petitions for, not petition, forget petition, applications for daycare and day nurseries you have received since January, roughly?
Places. Would you identify yourself, please?
I'm Judith Dooley, a member of the Zoning Board of Appeals. I do not have all of my minutes with me of the previous meetings. I came for other things.